So it's a great privilege for me to be with you today, especially since such august company. I didn't realise I was going to be in such august company, you know, with the general and members of the general council and all the sisters here. I feel as though all my life, I can say to some people, I've been sort of treading round on the, not the coattails, but the scapula of Teresa, if you like. I met Teresa when I was out in Spain on so many occasions was able to visit Avila and Segovia as well to see to meet with John of the Cross. And when I was in my third year in seminary, she really grabbed hold of me in a very special way, did Teresa. And I remember being in the spiritual reading library and picking up pleasure and a real privilege to take part in this day, and I'm very, very grateful to Johan for inviting me, and I'm very grateful that in this way I can still be part of the Carmelite family in this diocese and indeed throughout the whole of the country. It's wonderful to be able to introduce to you Professor Peter Tyler, because all during this week his name has been coming up over and over and over again. I've been out in Rome until last night, since last Sunday, and I've been at the Baylor College, and he was very much instrumental in assisting the Baylor to develop their degree course that they have over there. So his name kept on coming up in conversation, and I kept on seeing his signature at the bottom of all sorts of documentation that I was reading. So it's only right and fitting that I should be here today to introduce you. Peter Tyler is a professor of pastoral theology and spirituality at St Mary's University in London. His main area of research are Christian mysticism and the interaction of psychology and spirituality and pastoral theology. He's the director of INSPIRE, the Centre for Initiative in Spirituality and Reconciliation at St Mary's Twickenham. He's a registered psychotherapist and is a co-editor, I hope I get this pronunciation right, is the co-editor of Vinaya Sadhana, a journal for psycho-spiritual formation. He has a particular interest in the life and the writings of St Teresa of Avila and serves on the Teresa 500 planning of the Carmelite Forum of Britain and Ireland. Among his recent publications is included Teresa of Avila, Doctor of the Soul, The Bloomsbury Guide to Christian Spirituality, and St. John of the Cross, Outstanding Christian Thinker. You can also find many of his reflections on his blog, which is called In Soul Pursuit. We're delighted to welcome Tyler to speak to us today on the topic of entering the Cathedral of the Heart, St. Teresa of Avila and the medieval tradition. So it's with great pleasure, great joy that I introduce Peter before you. When I arrived at the Minster a couple of hours ago, I joined the communion service commemorating it, but we're not going to talk about it here. And the other person we're not going to talk about in the coon who's in the white and red roses is King Richard III. Apparently that's a sore point as well. First, when I'm talking
Spain and across the world, and still touches many people's hearts today, which brings us all here this afternoon. And I suppose there is a tendency sometimes to piety in the understanding of Teresa. I think there is another side of Teresa. Teresa as doctor of the church, first woman doctor of the church, as proposed by Pope Paul VI in 1970. And my own job as a theologian in the academy is to take her seriously as a theologian. Now, what I'm going to do this afternoon is talk about her theology, but her particular sort of theology. And this theology is what we call theologistica. It's not going to be too much Latin this afternoon, but this is a Roman Catholic church, and I work at Catholic University, so you're going to have a little bit. And the way I'm going to do that is I'm going to help us in a way to understand a little bit about York Minster, where we're going to be later on this afternoon. So you can see this, as well as a talk on Teresa, as a talk that's preparing us to enter into prayer when we go into the Minster later. And the Minster is prayer in stone. And I want to say a little bit about what that means, how that works. So the fundamental question really that a lot of this revolves around is, what is prayer? What do we do when we pray? And on one hand, that can seem like a very straightforward question. We can answer it very simply. But prayer is a sort of fascinating thing, and something that's very difficult to put into words. It's on the edge of words. Thomas Merton, the 20th century Trappist monk, whose centenary we also celebrate this year, called prayer a subtle nothingness. I think that's a very good definition of it. And it was something that Teresa, I say she walked around this notion of prayer. She kept walking around it, sort of worrying it, but looking at it from different angles. And it's a constant theme throughout her writings. This fundamental question, what is prayer and what do we do when we pray, was one that constantly exercised her. And she, as you know, she tried different expositions of prayer. There are four famous books she wrote: the Book of the Life, Bishop's already mentioned, The Way of Affection, one of her books that she particularly meant to be read by a wide audience. Some people say Teresa only wrote for her sisters. That's not exactly true. She did write for a wide audience as well. Foundations, and finally, the beginning of which I put up here, the Interior Castle. And in a way, you can see this prologue to the Interior Castle as her answer to that question, what is prayer? And partly to save my voice, but also so that you can actually hear a sister saying the words. Sister Jo has kindly said that she'll just read out that.
Thank you.
what she says in the interior castle, she presents before us the means of returning to the palace. In a way, the interior castle is a book with a happy beginning and a happy ending, because at the end of the book, we return to the palace. And she says the gate to this palace is prayer. She uses, well, another interesting, she uses various terms throughout the book. One of the words she uses is oration mental, which is normally translated into English as mental prayer. Now, in the book I wrote that was mentioned, Teresa of Avila, Doctor of Soul, one of the few things normally most critics ignore most books on religion, because religion is not terribly important in our society nowadays. But one of the few things that critics got a little exercised about in my book was that I substituted the word, instead of mental prayer, mindfulness. And I did that deliberately, because nowadays in this country, again, as many of you know, mindfulness is trending. It's something that you'll find often, even now, on the National Health Service, mindfulness-based therapies. If you look at Teresa's description of prayer, especially in the fourth action, the oration mental, it's a prayer that's moving out of the head into the heart. Which is why I think the word mental prayer is a little incorrect, because it gives a sense of too much headiness. As one of the Irish Carmelites said to me not so long ago, "Oh yes, you're right there," he said, "We Carmelites, we're not mental." When I was in, as the bishop said, I go to India most years. When I was in India earlier this year, I talked to a Buddhist monk about this. And we talked about the word sati, which is where we get the English word mindfulness. He actually said, mindfulness in itself is not a good translation of the Buddhist term, and perhaps heartfulness. I think heartfulness is probably the even better translation of what Teresa's talking about. So we have this heartfulness, this change of attitude, and she said in particular she emphasized the importance of acceptance, openness, and humility. If you can turn now to the second theme I want to talk about this afternoon, this idea of mystical theology, theologia mystica. This is really where I've earned my academic bread and butter, because I've spent, this is my life's work really, is to make this form of theology respectful again. And what has been interesting, it's an ongoing project. In June, St. Mary's, and you're all very welcome, we're having a big international conference with Teresa of Avila, and we'll have various luminaries, Professor Bertha McGinn from America, Archbishop Rowan Williams from the UK, and Professor Julia Christaver, French feminist writer. And as part of the research for that conference, I'm still working on this material. But what's becoming more and more apparent the more I look at this is how important this tradition was for Teresa. And by a happy coincidence, it's not just important for Teresa, but it's also important for Gothic architecture. So it forms a nice link between the two themes of today, Teresa of Avila and the Gothic building, the magnificent Gothic building we'll be praying in later today. What is it? Well, first of all, it's a way of knowing, or in particular, perhaps more correctly, a way of unknowing. It's very much this heart knowledge, what I was just talking about, rather than the head knowledge. It's also a way of theology. And if you go away and do a degree in a British university, or most European or American universities, what you are studying is what the medievals call speculative theology. Theologia speculativa. This is the theology that discusses the nature of Christ, the relation to the Trinity, and so on and so forth, the problem of evil, etc. In the medieval curricula, so for example, if you were to study in Paris in 1400, you weren't allowed to study just that sort of theology. Yes, you had to do the speculative theology, the head theology, but you also had to do this other theology, which was called the mystical theology or affective theology, the theology of the heart. And that's where Teresa is a master. That's why I call her a master of the soul. Master of theology. One of the key traditions where this comes from is the school of theology that grew up on the sides of the banks of Seine in Paris in the 11th, 12th, 13th centuries. This was centered around another beautiful bottle building, sadly no longer with us, it was destroyed in the revolution, the Abbey of Saint-Victoire. And the Victorines, as we call them, were people who were renowned for their exposition of theology of this gentleman, Dionysius, the Areopagite guide. Now the great thing about Dionysius is we don't know who he was, which is always a good thing, especially if you're an academic, because you can then fill up books and theses by who we have this person for. We think 6th century. The reason why I'm a bit confused is he took the name Dionysius Denis from the Acts of the Apostles. Remember, St. Paul goes to the Areopagus in Athens, preaches to the Greeks, and a few of them convert, one of whom is Denis. And for 1,500 years, scholars and religious Christians assumed it was writings. Now the good thing about that was that it gave him canonical status. So if you were to be in York Minster or Salisbury Cathedral or any of the other great medieval cathedral cities in the Middle Ages, you would have studied the letters of Denis and Dionysius along with the letters of St. Paul, St. James, St. John, and St. Peter. Now he is the master of what I said is unknown. Now, this is the this is the long bit of theology in the afternoon. I am a professor, so I'm going to do a little bit of theology. It's a very simple bit of theology. And it's really where all theology should start. The thing that makes theology so interesting is that everything you say about God cannot be God. Just give you a moment for that to sink in. God is not a creature, God is the creator. We have a problem, therefore. We can talk about the people we know, but we cannot talk about God. God, by definition, must be beyond all description. Denis, you'll sometimes see him called a pseudo after the 16th century when you realize he wasn't the person who knew St. Paul, he probably was in the 6th century. People started calling him Pseudo-Dionysius. I don't like the word pseudo, I think it's a bit rude, so I just call it Dionysius. So faced with this problem, how can we talk about the unknown God? We have three options. First is silence. We just say nothing. And that's a good option, you know. I'm sure many of the sisters here would agree with me there. It's not very good for academics, though. Students now pay £27,000 a year for their education, so I can't sit in silence with them. So if we're going to carry on talking, we have two options. The first is the classical scholastic tradition, what we call analogy. We'll come back to this. We'd say, although we can't talk about God as God is in God's self, we talk about how God may appear to be like. And this is again brings us back to the Gothic architecture in relation to the wonderful neo-Gothic building here. And the cathedral, the church, is a symbol. It's an analogy. It leads us up to how God could be. Don't worry, I'll come back to that shortly. The third option is what we call the aporia tension. We also call formative discourse. And this holds together the transcendent and the immanent. So every time we say, the person who's very good at this is Meister Eckhart. Meister Eckhart was so good at it, he got called up by the Inquisition. And he said to him, such as, whenever I say anything of God, I cannot be talking about God. Now, some of you will immediately be puzzling your heads and scratching your head and say, what on earth is this guy talking about? And that's exactly what these medieval writers wanted to happen. They wanted to put a spanner in the discursive intellect. And they're very good at it. So Eckhart says, God, free me from God. I mean, he did get sent to the Inquisition for saying that, but these are typical of what we're calling apophatic statements of the mystical theology. So these are what I'm going to talk about this afternoon, this unknowingness, and we find all of this in Teresa, the use of unknowingness, the use of the symbolic, and also the use of eros, the erotic. And all three of these we find in Teresa of Avila, as I'll show. The other key person in respect of this is Jean Gerson. He was the chancellor of Paris University. And he said, the mystical theology is irrational and beyond mind and foolish wisdom, exceeding all praise. Whereas the speculative theology, he says, uses reasoning in conformity with philosophical disciplines. Therefore, some call it learned, although these scholarly exercises are insufficient unless an individual seeks through hard study to gain proper conceptions of what has been conveyed by the greatest doctors. This is what I said earlier, you weren't allowed to study this on its own. Because, he says, otherwise, such people deal with theology only with their physical sense of hearing, as do children or magpies, not understanding what they are talking about or asserting nevertheless. We often still give them the name of theologians. I'm not mentioning any of my colleagues in particular with that. So we have a way of speaking, a way of writing, and a way of acting. And it's revealed in these three strategies: the apophatic, or the unknowing, the symbolic, and the erotic, or the affective. Let's look at them in turn. This is a quote from an heir of Thomas Aquinas and Meister Eckhart. I'm sure some of you met him, the Oxford theologian, Cain. Now remember throwing spanners into the works of the intellect. This is what he had to say to answer that question that I posed at the beginning of this afternoon, what is prayer? Prayer, he says, is really a waste of time. The incarnate form of our prayer may be concerned with getting something done, forwarding our plans, and the generosity of God is such that he will let himself be incarnate even in these ways. But the very heart of prayer is not getting anything done. It is a waste of time, an even greater waste of time than play. For a real, absolute waste of time, you have to go to prayer. Isn't that wonderful thing? And in a similar vein, Thomas Merton, who I mentioned earlier, writes, we should not look for a method or system, but cultivate, and again, while I'm reading these quotes, think of Teresa of Avila, because this is exactly, I would argue, how Teresa understands prayer. We should not look for a method or system, but cultivate an attitude, an outlook, faith, openness, attention, reverence, expectation, supplication, trust, and joy. All these finally permeate our being, insofar as our living faith tells us we are in the presence of God, that we live in Christ, that in the Spirit of God we see God our Father without seeing, we know him in unknowing. Now that could be written by any of our medieval writers, including Teresa. I warned you I was very bad at technology. This is, if you remember, the prologue that we began with, look at that for a wonderful statement of Apophasis. Remember, this is one of the greatest books on prayer ever written in any tradition, not just the Christian tradition. While I was beseeching our Lord today to speak, through me, as I was unable to find a thing to say or how to begin to comply with this obedience, what I was saying now presented itself. So, a wonderful statement of unknowing, and all the way through the interior castle, all the way through her writing, you have similar expressions. This is from Mansion 4. As these mansions are much closer to where the king lives, they have great beauty, and there are things so delicate to see and understand there, which the understanding does not have the capacity to grasp them. Although something might turn out to be well put and not at all obscure to the inexperienced, those who have experience, especially a lot of it, will understand very well. And that could have been straight out of Jean Chausson or the Victorines. And again, if you want to be scholarly argument, you can read in my books, you can actually trace where Teresa is getting this from. She was, as I say, a very clever woman, and she understood that any statement on prayer had to be prefaced by this statement of unknowing, uncertainty. Another great trick of Teresa's is to always put in before she starts the description. It appears to me, it seems to me. She always says this, it seems to me. There's always that slight relativization there. Now, that's all very well, but you know, the problem with this apophasis and some of my vice record is it gets just a little bit too empty. Man cannot live on apophasis alone, really. And I think there is a counter movement in prayer, this movement, what's called the via positiva. By the way, classic theologians always say John of the Cross is the great master of the via negativa, and Teresa is the great master of the via positiva. Because I'm that sort of person, I like to cross them over. So when I write a book about Teresa, I write about the via negativa in Teresa, and when I write about John, I write about the via positiva. My perversity, really. Now, this is the second thing, the symbolic. Now, again, this is extremely important for the medieval way of thinking. In a way, we are in a symbol. This church is a symbol. And later on, we're going to walk into another symbol. Again, an ancient Christian designation is something we see going back right to the beginning of Christian thought. The word symbol means that which brings together, that which throws together. And the opposite of the symbol is the diabol, the diabolic. The diabolic is that which throws apart. So again, in the medieval mind, especially in Teresa's mind, there's great play on the importance of the symbolic. Now, again, I'm sure I don't need to tell you about all the symbols that Teresa's used. This is a typical passage from Mansion 4 of the Morados. Interestingly enough, this is the mansion which begins by saying, we're now talking about supernatural thing of which we are at the balance of language. She writes, I don't know in what way or how they heard their shepherd whistling. It wasn't through the ears because nothing is heard. But one noticeably senses a gentle drawing inwards, as anyone who goes through this will observe, for I don't know how to make it clearer than that extent. It seems to me, there we go again, I have read that it is like a hedgehog or tortoise when they withdraw to themselves. The one who wrote this must have understood well. She's making a reference there to Francisco de Osuna. If you remember when she was at the end of a crisis in the 30s, sort of, most people do have a crisis in the 30s, that's what the 30s are for. But she had a sort of physical, mental, almost spiritual breakdown. And a wise uncle of hers gave her this book by Francisco de Osuna called The Third Spiritual Alphabet. And most people acknowledge that, but then they don't bother to read. If you actually read the Third Spiritual Alphabet, it is a primer in this mystical theology. So Teresa is getting this stuff directly from that book. And in the Book of the Life, she comes out with a remarkable statement. And remember at this time, Avila was a remarkable people. She says, in the 20 years of my life, I had no other spiritual director than this book. She said, this book was my master. 20 years. So this is of profound importance for understanding who Teresa was and how she was going to end up writing her own texts. And this is a typical example where she makes a clear reference to Osuna. Osuna uses this hedgehog and tortoise analogy or symbol, but he's talking about the recollection of incognito. Symbol of water, when she comes to write the interior castle, it's full of symbols. There's the castle itself. I came arrived by the train station here in York this morning, and I was surprised to see that you have the city walls still here, and they look remarkably well preserved. Very few of them left in that room. And these are the even better, if I may say, than the York City, of course, the walls of Avila. Of course, this is the city in which she was brought up, she knew most of her life. The castle in itself is a powerful symbol. Psychological terms, it's a way of holding the development of the soul, the development of the person. Another famous one is the water. Sister Jo's going to read us a passage on the water.
It seems to me that it can be watered in four ways. By taking water from the well, which is a lot of work, or by a water wheel and diving doves, when the water is drawn by our animals. I have sometimes drawn it in this way. It is less laborious than the other and gives me.
So again, we listen to the voice, very simple, very homely, very vivid metaphor, symbol for any Spaniard at that time. Teresa, when she founded her convent of San Jose in Avila, she had a big dispute with the city council because of the water supply, because the sister's new convent was interfering with the melted snow runoff. Which is so important for Avila. Again, anyone who reads Avila will know that it's a very dry, arid place. And yet, using this very simple and homely symbol, she's able to give us, in a wonderful way, the process of prayer, this movement from the more early active stages of prayer to the later passive stages of prayer, where she says, it rains, and we don't need to do any watering. In the fifth mansion is the famous symbol of the butterfly. She writes, "You will have heard of the wonderful way in which silk is made, a way nobody but God can see. You have heard how it comes from tiny eggs, like peppercorn seeds. I only know this second hand, for I've not seen it myself. So any inaccuracy will of course be mine. When the mulberry tree springs into leaf in warm weather, a tiny egg, which had been quite lifeless, begins to live. The caterpillar feeds on the mulberry leaves until it is full grown. Then people put down small twigs upon which the silkworm instinctively spins silk from its tiny mouth. It forms a narrow cocoon of silk into which it buries itself. Then, instead of this large, ugly worm, out of the cocoon becomes a lovely little white butterfly." This is an Indian butterfly. I quite like this one. I took this photograph myself. It looks a little bit beaten and warm, so I sort of empathize with this poor soul here. Again, as a water analogy, she's making this reference to the life of prayer, the two halves of prayer. The first half, when we're active, when we engage in hunting God, we read books, we come to lectures on Saturday afternoons, we go to the church a lot. Very, very active and busy. But she says this on its own is insufficient to get to where we want to be. The caterpillar, the worm, she says, must die. It must go into the chrysalis. And this is what she describes in the fourth mansion as this transition from active type of prayer to more passive type of prayer. And then out of that comes the butterfly. Again, she's using material from the tradition of mystical theology, the first stage of purification, all laid down by Dionysius, first stage of purification, second stage of illumination, and corresponds to the cocoon, third stage of union, which represents the butterfly. It's all there, if you know, it's all there. One last symbol of Teresa's is the lizard or snake. At the beginning of the castle, she says, she gives the vision of the camera, she says it's surrounded by these lizards and snakes that try and get in to the castle. And she says, this is very psychologically very interesting. These are distractions of life. These are those things I said at the beginning that are stopping us entering the castle. The first few mansions are very much about the battle with these lizards and snakes. But then when we get to that all-important fourth mansion, the fourth mansion is the pivot in which the whole of the castle turns. She says something very interesting. In such a short passage, says, lizards or snakes rarely enter these mansions, but if they do, they cause more good than harm. It's interesting. And in psychological terms, I think of the work of Carl Jung. Carl Jung, the 20th century analyst, said that we each of us have a shadow, parts of personality that we don't accept. Press, or we, even worse, project onto the other. There's an awful lot of shadow projection going on at the moment. We not only do it personally, but we do it culturally. We find groups on which we present the shadow. And one of the tragedies of the world is that we begin to believe the shadow. But Jung said in one of his writings that the shadow is 99% I think that's what Teresa is all about when she talks about her lizards. Because if we've reached that state of awareness, attentiveness, mindfulness, heartfulness, whatever we want to do, whatever we want to call it, where we can accept our ugly side, our suppressed side, it, as she says, can do more good than harm. That's why I think she's a great psychologist as well as a great theologian. About Gothic art. I like this quote. This is from John Evelyn, 1660. Greek and Roman architecture answered all the perfections required in a faultless and accomplished building. The Goths demolished these and introduced in their stead a certain fantastical and licentious manner of building. Congestions of heavy, dark, melancholy, monkish piles, without any just proportion, use, or beauty. Gothic art was terribly unpopular, as you can see, in the 17th century. In fact, Gothic art was refined at Story Hill, where I work in Twickenham by Horace Walpole, and this building we're standing in is part of that neo-Gothic revival. But to see Gothic art in that disparaging way is to completely miss the point. Rather, if you want to understand Gothic art, and when you're sitting in the cathedral this afternoon, you have to know mystical theology. Because when the Victorines were working on developing the mystical theology in Paris, 12th, 13th centuries, this gentleman, Albert Suger, was developing Gothic art. It's a nice statue, so enjoy it. What was he building? The Abbey of St. Dionysius. The Abbey of St. Dionysius. You can still see it. I did that a couple of years ago. It's in one of the poorest suburbs of Paris nowadays, a whole cathedral dedicated to this gentleman, Dionysius. And if you want to understand the Gothic art, don't have a look at the great west door of the Cathedral of Saint-Denis, which is a beautiful thing in itself. And there you'll find this inscription. There it is in Latin, have it in English. This is the key to understanding it.
Whoever thou art, if thou seekest to extol the glory of these things, marvel not at the gold, nor at the expense, but at the craftsmanship. Right is the noble work, but being noble right, work should brighten the minds, so that they may travel.
So you see all the themes I'm developing this afternoon, the otherness of God, the transcendence, but we can get glimpses of the transcendence of the symbol through the Gothic world, the Gothic architecture within which we enter. To understand the medieval mind, and I'm not the first person to say this, this has been said by many scholars, you have to understand the medieval mind is essentially symbolic. Our minds are essentially dialectic. We love dialectic, and we love prime minister's question times, debates, referendums, etc. That's not the medieval mind. This is a typical passage from the Victorians. A symbol is a juxtaposition, that is, a gathering together of visible forms in order to demonstrate invisible things. And if you look at the medievals, they were obsessed by it. In the medieval cathedral, every colour had a significance. The number had significance. I'm a bit of a Gothic anorak, or trainspotter, and I spent this afternoon, this morning you'd have seen me in the Minster, counting all the numbers, because everything has a symbol. This is the Great East Window, which you won't be able to see in the last time, because it's being restored at the moment. But I think it's been brought back to life again in a couple of years' time, so those of you in New York will have the pleasure of seeing it. I don't know when I'll see it. But if you look at the Great East Window, here I'm going to have to leave the microphone. In your anorak, you count the number of windows. You do this during the evening cycle, when you get bored.
They would have seen this as something written by an apostle of Christ. It's not just a
bit of interesting theology. So when Dionysius writes on St. Paul, he says, this is why the great Paul, swept along by his yearning for God and seized of his ecstatic power, had this inspired word to say, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Paul was truly a lover, and as he says, he was beside himself with God, possessing not his own life, but the life of the one for whom he yearned in Eros as exceptionally beloved. And Teresa gets this from this tradition, this Dionysian tradition, and she uses it in her writing. The famous famous passage, we won't read that one because you'll probably all know it so well. The famous passage of the Transfiguration in the Book of Light, unfortunately given the makeover by Bernini in the statue of Santa Maria di Vittoria. I never show that picture, by the way, because the problem with that picture is it focuses on the erotic rather than the eros. And the point that Teresa is making in the passage is this Dionysian one of the eros, the erotic, the yearning act of. It's not sexual for the sake of sex, it's eros, the means by which we transport it back. And you can, you know, I've argued this, but you can see this very clearly because that famous passage in the Book of Life, Bernini uses the basis for statue, is more or less repeated at the very end of the life in the interior castle. And Sister Jo will read this out to us now. As she reads it, notice that Teresa uses almost exactly the same language that she used 25 years earlier in the Book of Delight. And I think when you see it like this, without any of the sort of fancy Baroque stuff, you can see that she's making more this point of the mystical theology, the role of the Eros in bringing us back to our living God.
So powerful is the effect of this on the soul.
Yes.
And the soul is
the other interesting thing in the passage is she uses that interesting little phrase, the little spark will scintilla. This is, again, almost a direct reference to what the mystical theologians call the scintilla, the part or the synthesis, the part where the soul meets God. Now, she's clearly got a lot of this stuff from Francisco de Osuna. What's very interesting is what I'm looking at the moment is that the stuff that she uses that's not in the Pseudo. And I do wonder whether she perhaps knew more than is even contained in the Pseudo. And that's what I'm working on the moment. If you want to hear my argument for that, come to the old conference in June. So I'll get that finished by then. To conclude then, the mystical theology that Teresa is heir to is caught, not taught. And it's at the heart of what prayer is about. And what she's developing in the interior castle is a school of prayer. But at the end of the castle, she's very clear and very insistent in some of the most striking passages. She writes, "When I see people very diligently observing the sort of prayer that they have, and very wrapped up in it, when they have it, for it seems that they will not let the thought move or stir, in case they lose a small morsel of gusto, devotion that they have had, I realize how little they understand the road to the attainment of union. They think that the whole business lies in such things. No, sisters, no. The Lord desires works, and that if you see a sick woman to whom you can give some help, never be affected by the fear that your devotion will suffer, but take pity on her. If she is in pain, you should feel pain too. If necessary, fast so that she may have more food, not so much for her sake as because you know that the Lord desires her." So it's not a prayer for the sake of prayer. The end of prayer, she said very clearly, is good works. This is the reason for prayer, my daughters. The purpose of the spiritual marriage, the birth always of good works, good works. I repeat, it is necessary that the foundation consist of more than prayer and contemplation. If you do not strive for virtues and practice them, you will always be dwarfed. So, to finish with, in summary, she writes, "It is not so essential to think much as to love much." This is a constant theme in her writing. Again, it's one of the themes of the mystical theology. "Do not think," she writes, "you can attain God by thinking that he resides in your soul." And also that we must remember we are incarnate, libidinal, bodily people. Look after yourself, she says. Look after your body. Make sure you eat well, you sleep well. When you meet any obstacles, she says, never use any violence. And finally, she writes, "In this process of prayer, be gentle with yourself as God is gentle." Thank you very much.
Easier from the microphone if you want.
He's the boss.
That's a fantastic question. Do I use prayer in counseling? Funnily enough, I've just written a book about it. I wrote a book last year. I only write four books really to try and answer questions that I have from time to time. So I write a book and then other people find it interesting. The book was called Picturing the Soul.
revisioning psychotherapy, spiritual direction.
When I trained as an analyst 20 years ago, it was in a secular institute, actually mostly Jewish. I was the only Christian group, and they were fascinated by me. It was wonderful to have all this attention. And even to this day, whenever they have people with religious neurosis, they send it to me. It's constant flow of people. And when I started training as an analyst, it was sort of drummed into me, keep this separate from the spiritual side. I had also trained or been initiated into the tradition of spiritual direction in the Ignatian tradition. And still, I don't see that many people, but I still see one or two people for spiritual direction. So for many years, I kept the two things apart. But whether I'm getting more sloppy, or I don't know what it is, or whether I'm just getting old, as I go on, I find the two do merge together much more. I wouldn't say I pray with my secular clients. That would not be the yoke in which I work. But, you know, anyone who comes to see me for therapy, they only have to Google my name and find I'm doing things like this. Saturday afternoon. I find I have a lot of people come to me nowadays who have an interest in the spiritual, and they're finding that interest, that hunger, fascination. You know, Rudolf Otto, great German, wrote this brilliant book in the middle of the 20th century called in English The Idea of the Holy, and he said, what are the qualities of qualities of God, the transcendence, the movement, the tremens, the power, and the fascinans. We're drawn towards the spiritual. You can't stop it. This is the Eros. You know, John of the Cross, I was drawn from my house. Always be constantly led by God. So you can try address psychology with the secular clothing, but the spiritual always out. I've just finished a book, well, it's going to be finished in 2 weeks' time after the publishers, and it's called The Pursuit of the Soul. And what I've done in this book, I've looked at the early Christian understandings of the soul, and then I've looked at the early psychoanalytical understandings of the soul. Freud never used the word mind. Freud used the German Seele or soul. When it gets translated into English, they change the word from soul to mind. So when I teach Freud to my students, I say, get the pen out. Wherever it says mind in the text, scrub it out and put the word soul. It immediately changes the whole thing. So I think, to answer your question, it's an ongoing conversation. It's a wonderful conversation. And you know, great things can happen. Around. You know, when you sit to pray, all the
these thoughts come into your head, you know, did I switch the gas off, what time does waitress close, etc., etc. These are distractions, these little gnats, and what people like Teresa offer, and the early fathers and mothers of the desert, is one of the ways of getting down from the head, the busy mind, into the heart. And the repetition of the prayer, the Hail Mary, our Father, the repetition of prayer is a way of moving from the head to the heart. So, yeah, wonderful.
I used to work
savages. And then they said, oh yes, that's very nice. And they said, is Father so-and-so here? I said, he may be here, but I think they've all gone out today. But we've come to see him. I'm the provincial from such and such order. So I felt about that big. So I thought, I always think of that little result. And they were delighted when I told them. I thought they were homeless bag living. And I made their day. Still in touch.
So, final question. Yes. You have to speak very loud.
Yeah. Teresa was moved by two things, among others, to reform her life and to make it reform. And the division of the church in Europe, the Protestant Reformation.
World in flames.
World in flames. And then South America, all these souls being lost in South America. Where Teresa alive today? What do you think would move her today?
Thank you, Father.
I can ask for your answer.
Great question there. Father John, by the way, is a great expert on Rathia, and whose anniversary as well was celebrated. And do talk to him after about Rathia. Father John's question, Teresa was moved by the plight of the Reformation and the souls in Spanish and the Indies. If Teresa was alive today, what would be her concerns? And I'm going to get you to give your answer. It's a very, very interesting question. I am more and more convinced, one thing that shines out very strongly for me in my own personal encounter with Teresa is her intelligence. And she was an incredibly intelligent woman who was not really given much opportunity to develop it. I mean, if you looked at her mother, who presumably was also intelligent, you know, died very young having given birth to all these children, entering a convent was probably one of the few ways in which intelligent women such as Teresa could really blossom and develop herself. I think that she would be, and here I'm very much, when I answer your question, I always think Stein. And Edith Stein is for me the latter day Teresa of Avila, a highly intelligent Jewish woman. One of the most adept philosophers of late 19th century Germany. And that's a pretty high accolade because there were some big brains hanging around late 19th century Germany. She didn't get to the highest position because she was a woman. What Edith was particularly concerned with the role of women, and she wrote some really interesting stuff in the new book on the soul. I've concluded the final chapter with the writings of Edith Stein, because I find in Edith the wisdom, the humour, the power of Teresa in a sort of modern guise. And you know, it's taken us 500 years to unpack Teresa of Avila, it would take us 500 years to unpack Edith Stein. So I think the role of women would be something of particular concern to her. What do you think, Father John?
No, I don't think.
You don't think. We're diplomatic.
So, brothers and sisters, we had I think a very good and very full afternoon, and I'm very personal, from a very personal point of view, I'm so grateful to have been here and to be present at this lecture. If for nothing else, to know that I actually must be getting very holy. Certainly, if by the definition that we were given there with regarding prayers being a waste of time and not getting anything done. Also, I think in an era where that word eros is only translated in terms of erotic and has been snatched by the world and commandeered by Satan and all the rest of it, to know that it's very much a holy word, and to know that it's very much part of our spirituality, that, that God uses that to seize us and to draw us closer to Him. And I think I experienced that in Teresa actually when I read her. I don't think I would have been able to put it into words, but she was somehow expressing to me in her words just how she had been captured by the Lord and drawn deeper and deeper into that love and to that friendship with Him. And I wanted to be part of that. I wanted some of that in my life too. And so I'm very, very grateful to have heard those thoughts reiterated this afternoon. Thank you very much for sharing your